क्या आप आईएएस की तैयारी कर रहे हैं और कोचिंग इंस्टीट्यूट को 2.5 लाख तक की फीस नहीं पे करना चाहते? अगर हाँ तो 22,500 रुपए में घर बैठ के StudyIQ के पेनड्राइव कोर्स के साथ आप आईएएस की तैयारी कर सकते हैं। आज ही विजिट करें studyiq.com।
Very good morning and a very warm welcome to StudyIQ. I am Prashant Mavani. I hope you all are doing good. Let's have a positive start. Every flower is a soul blossoming in nature. Think about it, dear friends. And with this, we have a very important article on nature or climate change. But before that, we are going to go through this editorial. It's called Retrograde Move. Retrograde Move is about a decision taken by Punjab's cabinet. And this decision is about, this act of sacrilege against holy books. Sacrilege basically means, to destroy something, particularly things associated with religion or something that is considered holy. So if someone is found guilty of, sacrileging these holy books of major religions like you have Bible, Quran, Bhagavad Gita, then that person will be chucked behind the bars for the whole life. A life imprisonment is a punishment that, that has been decided by Punjab's cabinet. Remember, it's not a law yet. It is just a decision. When I say just, I mean to say that, of course, it has to go through this important process of legislative assembly, but when we talk about cabinet, then we are talking about heart and mind of any government. So decision of a cabinet is very important one as well, right? At the same time, this law is a bit too harsh, and this is the reason why we find this word retrograde here. I'm not saying that everything that is old is not good or it's always bad. No, that's not right. But when it comes to law, generally speaking, right, we prefer modern laws rather than retro laws, which are outdated most of the time. Now, back in 2016 as well, Punjab Assembly came out with this amendments. It tried to amend this IPC, but at that point of time, central government returned this bill because it was just talking about covering one holy book, and the name of this holy book is Guru Granth Sahib. Back in 2016, Punjab government tried to protect just one book, and this was considered, and of course it is, isn't it? It is anti-secular as well as it is discriminatory too, which is against the nature of our whole society. It is against our constitution, of course. And one more thing that I would like to add here is that if you are following current affairs for a bit of long time, now when I say long time, I mean to say that if you are aware about incidents of 2014, 15 and 16. So this was the time when, this sacrilege of, very sad thing of course, right, sacrilege of Guru Granth Sahib was reported in news in this area of Punjab, and a few incidents took place out of Punjab as well. So this is something that is not right. No person has right to abuse someone or to say something abusive about or do something that is against the principle, or that will definitely hurt someone as far as this religious sentiments are concerned. But the big problem here is that we have, right, if you talk about this decision of Punjab cabinet, then we need to think, take this thing into consideration, that we already have section 295A of Indian Penal Code that deals with this blasphemy. And 3 years, if someone is found guilty, then 3 years, I believe, is more than enough, to teach a particular person a good lesson. So, of course, life imprisonment is something that is not acceptable. At the same time, what we need to understand is that, we have seen misuse of laws as well. Law will create this sense of fear, of course. But we have some people, they are in small numbers, thank God, in our society and in our country. But still, we do have them. And these people are mischievous elements, right? What they want is they want to create some sort of political turmoil, or they want to hurt someone else, or they want to throw some mud on someone else's religion, forgetting this thing that if you try to hurt someone's feeling, or if you're trying to, you know, project to someone else's religion as a bad religion, then in fact you are doing more harm to your own religion. The other thing is, because of this sort of things, you know, back in 1957 as well, Supreme Court has clarified that this section of for this punishing people who are indulging in this sort of activities is of course something that is not acceptable, because this can, you know, work as a sort of fuel or a spark for riots in our society. And once you have this sort of cracks taking place in any society, then it takes ages, you know, to fill up this cracks or this this valley that will be created by this riot. So we don't want to see this thing at all. Laws are good. We need a solid law. But more than that, we need implementation of law. And life imprisonment is something I believe this time as well. It will create a bit trouble for this Punjab cabinet. And we have to also take into this, you know, sensibility and our own discretion power, you know, to identify and distinguish that something that has been said by someone, may it be politician or a particular individual, we have to understand this thing, that we have to identify what is the main motive behind this sort of act. So someone is trying to create trouble in society, right? So as a society, everyone should cooperate with each other. This is the only solution that we have. Then on secondary, we have laws as well. If you want to download the PDF of today's lecture, you will get it from my Facebook page as well as Facebook profile and my Twitter handle. Now, one of the most important article that we find in today's The Hindu is this pulling back from brink. It is about hot house earth. Now, this is a new thing, hot house earth, right? It was recently, this terminology was used in this magazine called Proceedings of National Academy of Science. And what hot house earth basically means, that reaching a particular stage, or you can say a phase, right, of high temperature, that once you enter this phase, then there is no return ticket at all. And this is a very dangerous thing, because once we hit this tipping point, then things will, you know, from there, things will be very bad. If you don't know what tipping point is, let me give you a small example here, right? You can take example of any product or any person. You know, I'll give you youngsters, I'm sure we all are watching films, so yeah, I'm sure you would be aware about this actor called Nawazuddin Siddiqui, right? So for a very long period of time, his career graph was, you know, it was average, or you can say he used to do small roles, but all of a sudden his work was recognized, and this here you can say this is tipping point of his career. Now at present he's going just up. In the same way, once we cross this 2 degrees Celsius, if our average temperature crosses this 2 degrees Celsius, then after that, once we cross this tipping point, and in fact it is going to kick many, it is going to kick, if we cross this 2 degrees Celsius, then we are going to see this series of tipping points, and this whole thing, you know, will destroy our earth. It is just like, you know, pushing this set of dominoes. Yesterday we were talking about this thing, that if elephant goes down, then the tiger will, if tiger goes down, then the jungle will, and if the jungle goes down, then eventually our society and as an individual, we all will go down. So our earth is getting warmer and warmer, and because of this thing, we can see many, you know, many things that will, we want to be able to restore those things. So we need to be very careful with the way we are dealing with this scenario. I'll give you one more example of no return ticket. I'm sure you have heard about this island, big island called, hold on, Greenland, right? And this Greenland is completely covered with, it's a bit ironical, but it's completely covered with ice, and then you have Iceland that is mostly covered with grass. So anyways, here the main concern is that or the main focus here is that Greenland, right, what is happening is because of this you know, global warming, this ice that you see here or snow that you see here is melting, and it's of course melting and becoming water, big puddle of water, you can say. Now, what happens with open water? If you compare open water and ICC, then ice or this, snow, bigger pardon, ice or snow or open water, then open water has more capacity. It will absorb more sunlight and thus it will become more, it will get more heated compared to this ice and snow. And it will again kick, more. It will increase this warming, this water, and so you can understand that more warming, then more ice and snow will melt, and it will get warmer and warmer. So eventually, we will see no ice if the way things are going on. And it's not just about ice, right? It's about environment that we are talking about. It's about biodiversity that we are talking about. So this is just a small example of Greenland, but this is something that is going on in different parts of our world. Technology trends and decisions that we will take now or at this point of time or in next decade or next two decades will decide where we are heading, whether we are heading towards a destruction or whether we are heading towards repairing what we have destroyed. CO2 level at present is 400 ppm and temperature at present that we have is 1 degree Celsius higher than pre-industrial era. Pre-industrial era, we are talking about 1750s era, and before that our Earth's average global temperature was 1 degree lower than what we have today. 3 to 4 million years ago, if you go back, then we find this mid Pleistocene era, and during this Pleistocene era, this sea level was 10 to 22 meter higher. This is a GK thing for you, general knowledge thing. And if you see mid Miocene era, then 15 to 17 million years ago, at that point of time, carbon dioxide was 300 to 500 ppm. At present, we are what, 400 ppm, which is a very bad thing. And at that point of time, sea level were 10 to 60 meters higher than what we have today. I'm sure you all are aware about this Paris Agreement of 2015, and the main, you can say, target of Paris Agreement is that we will try our level best. The first priority, we will try that we will keep this global average temperature below 1.5 degrees Celsius by the end of this century. And if not by 1.5, then it should never cross 2 degrees Celsius, right? This is our target. But there are many scientists out there. They are saying that we are easily, we are going to cross this 2 degrees Celsius. The way things are going on, it looks like we are going to cross this 2 degrees Celsius. And remember, once we cross this 2 degrees Celsius, we are talking about this tipping point. And now you know what tipping point is all about. So technological solutions, right? When I say climate change and all these things, of course, technological solutions or technology trends play a very important role because of what we are using for transportation, right? Our energy, from where or from what sources our energy is coming. All these things are important. But more than that, right, the most important thing is our behavior, our values, our governance, how much we are paying attention to this thing. We find people out there, right? They are wasting too much of energy. They need all this, gadgets. And I'm not saying having gadgets and things is a bad thing, but at least when you are not using it, you should switch it off, right? You can pay electricity bills. That does not mean that you should waste electricity, because every that fan that is rotating in your ceiling or air conditioning, remember that carbon dioxide or this carbon has been released out there, because still we are producing this thermal, we are getting, a big chunk of electricity is coming from thermal source. So we have to think for every one of us, and this is what Paris or this United Nations Climate Change is all about. And one more example that I would like to add here is that, see dear friends, you have two different poles of Earth, as you can see here. This is North Pole, of course, Arctic Ocean, and this is South Pole, Antarctic continent. The difference here, from the name itself, you can say that this is an ocean that we are talking about. Here you find snow, but it is basically a freezed ocean. And if you come here to the South Pole, then it is a continent, right, on which you find snow. So this is, you know, one here snow on land, and here you find snow on water, or ice on water and ice on land to be more specific. Now, if we are losing Arctic oceans, or this snow here, if snow melting is taking place here, then if, you know, if we take necessary steps, then we can restore, right, we can restore this snow or ice. But once we lose the snow from Antarctica, we will not be able to bring it back. So this is again a thing that has no return ticket. So hot house, again, hot house earth is a phase from where we have no return ticket, and it is associated with high temperature of our planet. I hope things are clear to you. It's most important, right? One of the most important article that you can read in today's The Hindu newspaper. And now the next item that we have is In Search of Greatness. Again, a very interesting article, and it is about science, and it is again about not only science, but it is also about culture that is a bit lacking as far as science is concerned in our country. But you have this medal that you can see on your screen. It's a Fields Medal, and this Fields Medal is given to, or it's awarded to, those mathematicians who are below 40 years of age, and you know, it is given once in 4 years, and it is given to two to four mathematicians only. So far, you know, till 2014, no woman had won this medal. Until back in 2014, Iranian lady won this for the first time. So hats off to her. As far as Indians are concerned, we haven't seen any Indians winning this award in maths, right? But and one more thing, this Fields Medal is equivalent to Nobel Prize. Now, so far, we haven't seen any Indians winning this thing, but back in 2014, Indian origin Canadian-American mathematician, his name is Manjul Bhargava, was awarded this Fields Medal. And back in this year itself, the latest one, 2018, Australian mathematician, his name is Akshay Venkatesh. So you know that he is also a person from Indian origins. Now, thing is, when it comes to, you know, this sort of names, then we take a pride that at the end of the day, this gentleman, they are from India, right? But the thing is, if we ask this question, right, an honest question, then we find that we haven't, as a country, we haven't contributed anything in their growth as mathematicians, right? But this also, you know, this reality also forces us to ask this question, that why this sort of things are going on, why we find that, you know, it's of course Indian people are no doubt hardworking people, right? A little bit talent as well. I'm not saying that it would be a sort of egoistic thing that I would say that we are the most talented. No, that's not right, right? We all have same capacity as far as this nature is concerned. It has given us reasonably, you can say, same capacity. Now it's up to us how we make the most out of it. So Indian origin scientists are doing very well as far as this, you know, different fields are concerned, particularly abroad, they are doing very well. This indicates that we have this potential, right? But when it comes to, you know, our systems, right, why don't we find, what is the real problem here? The real problem is not about, you know, it's not about Indians. It is more about our system or institutions that we have here. And this is the thing that needs to be sorted out. And if you see, if you compare Indians in other fields, right, then you will find that we have, you know, produced many world beaters as well. Like talk about chess, talk about badminton. Apart from that, you will find global leaders in music, arts, literature. They are from India, born and bred here in India, you know, and this also, you know, forces us to ask this question, that why this sort of scenario? Because if you go to, you know, this field of music or arts and literature, then we hardly find support coming from government. But when it comes to education, right, from the very starting, you know, education is supported by government. So without support of government or without support of any corporate sector, why we find this global leaders, right, in music, in arts, in literature, and in other fields? Of course, Indians are there. Why we find Indians over here, but why don't we find them when it comes to this sort of scientific medals? The big difference is that here, this music, arts, literature, or maybe chess or sport, right? It is this personal sacrifices, this hard work that was done by that particular players or their family members or their coach, you know. Together, they have, created this reality for themselves. But when it comes to science, still we find that the nature of school education is a bit outdated. If we go around the world, then we find that students are becoming more and more independent, right? They are taking their own decisions and how to sort out things and all these things. But here again, spoon feeding and, you know, rank, how much percentage you get and all these things are more important. And this is something that is provided or promoted, you know, in the school. And it is, of course, something that is demanded by society. So here, if we want to, you know, turn the tables, then we need to, you know, we need to promote this culture of excellence. And if we want to promote this culture of excellence, then it cannot take place in isolation. If you want to create great work, then you have to support other areas as well. It's not that if you want to excel in science, then just open more and more science schools and, you know, and then your job will be done. No, that's not possible. It's the whole society, you know. It's like a cobweb, you know. If you strengthen one string, then it will add strength to this whole cobweb. And if you break one string, then it will create troubles for other. So it's the ripple effect will be felt everywhere. Same thing happens, right? If we support science, if we support art, if we support sports, you know, literature, all these things together creates this talent pool of our society. And we need to stop this, you know, victimization of our students are being forced. There are so many families, they force their kids to go for science, even if that particular kid is good with art or philosophy or literature. So this is a culture that we need to create if we want to see ourselves in this list of medals. Our Indians, right? Not people from Indian origin. Of course, they have this Indian blood, but what I'm saying is we need someone from homeland, right, to get this awards. Now, the last item that we have is tilting at windmills. Again, a very important item here, and you'll find some facts here. Apart from that, I'm sure regular students, you know very well about global value chain and supply chain, because I have explained this thing to you just in the recent past. Let me give you a small overview of this article here. It is about president of Cambodia. So something associated with politics of Cambodia. It was in a form of editorial a couple of weeks ago. And again, so you can drop this one. This is about two movies, right, projecting a particular community. Again, you can drop this one. And this is again about Greece and its political crisis and economic crisis and things like that. Again, not that important as far as your exam is concerned. So tilting at windmill, which is a very important current affair topic. It is associated with this protectionism that is created by Mr. Trump. And Mr. Trump is simply ignoring the complexity of global supply chain. If you don't know what global supply chain is, then this is the picture here. You know, if you are purchasing something in India, but that thing, you know, a raw material could be produced in Brazil, and it is, a sort of process is done in China, then this particular item is sold to USA. So all it's today, you observe yourselves, right? You are using a phone of an American company that is produced in China. You are using it in India, battery coming from some other country and body coming on from some. So there are so many products out there. They are all, you know, a part of this global supply chain. And when you are creating this wars, you are disrupting this whole global supply chain, because almost 60% of Chinese exports to USA, right, they are not owned by Chinese companies. In fact, it is investment done by other countries or companies from other countries like UK, USA, you know, companies from Germany and other companies, they are the ones who have invested, and most of the items that are produced in China are 60% items that are reaching this shores of USA. They are produced by some countries belonging to other countries, companies belonging to other countries. Now, the thing is, what happens when, say, for example, some computer routers or things that are essential that are not produced in USA, and if you have to buy it from somewhere else, or raw material, you have to buy it from some other country, and if you are, you know, adding this tariffs or creating these walls, at the end of the day, what will happen is that consumers of USA, they will be paying more, right? They will be paying more for that essential item. The Peterson Institute of International Economics estimates that 87% of computers and electronics, which constitute the largest share of Chinese exports to US, includes parts and financing from other countries like South Korea, Japan, and US itself. So this is a sort of eye-opener for Mr. Trump. The other thing is, we have one more example of Germany. When China will impose a retaliatory tariffs on USA, right, what will happen is that it will have a negative impact on German car producer BMW, because the biggest car factory of BMW is in USA and not in Germany. It's good that BMW has always invested in, you know, in upgrading the skill of their employees, right? But if this sort of trade wars, you know, if this sort of trade wars will continue, then what will happen is that everyone will suffer, and it is not going to be healthy as well. Tim Cook, who is CEO of Apple, has said that one of the main reasons why the company has shifted production to China is not because of cheap labor, but it is about wider pool of skilled labor that does the USA, you know, that has much wider, China has much wider this skilled labor compared to what USA is having. And this is one of the reasons why companies are going there. So it's not just about, you know, investment going out. There are various different reasons. At some place you find good raw material, at other places you find good labor, just like China. Countries like India, you have other specialties. So this is not healthy for the whole world. Now, dear friends, that's everything in articles. Now, let's quickly go through important news. Kerala government has said that except 700 crore help that is offered by UAE, or else central government can give us 700 crore rupees because we need money for development. That's what CM and finance minister of or important ministers of Kerala are saying. India and Pakistan ties are key to regional stability, has been said by China. Visited Pakistan as a goodwill ambassador, has been said by Sidhu. Four killed, 23 hurt in Mumbai high-rise fire. Violent incidents mar Eid festival. It's very sad that a few small chunk of people are celebrating Eid by throwing stones, and then you have good people, right? And they are celebrating Eid by helping someone else. NGT asks for action plan on e-waste in 3 months. Dear friends, Kerala needs... means government has said that Kerala, right, to support Kerala, or to, you know, make sure that Kerala is standing back on its feet. We don't, at present, we need, don't need help from some foreign country. So we have politely said no to UAE. Quad grouping is again in news. Quad stands for this four members, India, Australia, Japan, and USA. One of the main agenda is to protect Indian Ocean region and Pacific region, so Indo-Pacific region, and one of the main agenda again, right, the top priority is to make sure that China is not misbehaving. Then you have ISRO awaits advanced materials that are produced in our country, and curbing open urination is going to be the next step. I think yesterday we were talking about this thing. Now you can see financial news here. Views or recommendations. Now it is in news, this thing. It is about High Court Collegium. And let me tell you that in High Court Collegium, you have three members. One is CJI, and then you have two Supreme Court, or beg your pardon, High Court, that particular High Court's senior most judges after chief justice of that particular high court. So the collegium consists of three members, and the Supreme Court collegium has five members. Keep this thing in mind and go through it as well, dear friends. I'm sure it's not going to be that difficult for you guys to go through it once you download this PDF. I'm just giving you a gist of this thing. It is again about internet firms and rules and regulations associated with e-commerce. This one is about made in India, not make in India, but made in India. If we produce 225 million handsets, right, then we are saving what, 60,000 crore rupees in foreign exchange saving. MG Narega may see there is a pressure on government to increase this Narega wages. And here you can see that wheat is a very sensitive crop. We have lost a big chunk of wheat production because of this climate change. You can see here the person on your screen, his name is Michael Flynn, and Michael Flynn has accepted this thing that or he is found guilty of having a connection with Russia. These are your vocabularies. Yesterday I asked you a question about aid. It stands for assistant or auxiliary or adjutant. And then you have devoted, very loving or loyal. Peasant means a poor farmer of low social status. And generous is showing a readiness to give more of something as money or time than it is strictly necessary. Here I have a question for you. It is extinction. What is the meaning of this word extinction? Answer for your question. Let me take you through it. On the north side, you have the most on the northwest side is Hanoi. Then you have this Nay Pi Tho, Vientiane. Then you have Manila, Bangkok, Phnom Penh, Bandar Seri Begawan, Kuala Lumpur, Singapore, and last is Jakarta. Can you identify this region here? And these are your answers. These are your new questions, dear friends. Please help yourself with it. And don't forget to check out studyiq.com to find out more about our pen drive and tablet courses. Enjoy your studies. God bless you all. I will see you all tomorrow. Till then, Jai Hind.